This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pain.
I am Vanguard.
Pain.
The year is 2013, and it's Doctor Who's 50th anniversary year. It's time for celebration, and while the silver marching monstrosities known as the Cybermen did not wind up featuring in the anniversary special proper, they did manage to make an appearance that year in an episode penned by acclaimed writer Neil Gaiman, riding high after the hugely successful Series 6 story, The Doctor's Wife. In fact, his involvement with this story was announced when he received a Hugo Award in 2012 for that episode.
Obviously, having written an episode that everybody loved, it would be the act of a fool or a madman to try and do it again. So I'm on the third draft right now.
Enter Nightmare in Silver, the episode that was known for two things before its broadcast. One, the story whose script got left behind in the back of a Cardiff taxi, and two, the story where Neil Gaiman's main goal was to have the Cybermen be scary again. A noble objective, since, on TV at least, the Cybermen had a pretty mixed streak in the revived series. But did Gaiman succeed? Well, let me back up. The 11th Doctor has been forced by Clara Oswald, played by Jenna Coleman, to take the two kids that she's nannying for to space so that they don't out her as a time traveller to the rest of her family. So they're taken to a space amusement park, but it's abandoned. All that seems to remain there is a punishment platoon of soldiers and impresario Webley, who has a collection of alien artifacts, waxworks, and also an empty cybersuit that plays chess, though it is secretly controlled by another human being called Porridge. The suit is apparently harmless, with the Cybermen having been wiped out 1,000 years ago. However, there is a dormant army waiting underneath the planet's surface, about to be awoken, and not only are these Cybermen highly advanced, but they've just gained access to the most powerful asset on this planet, the Doctor's mind, with the Cyberplanner attempting to take over. It's up to Clara to fight off the new army of Cybermen with the platoon, and the battle for the Doctor's mind will be resolved via a game of chess. Now, on paper, that's an awesome premise. However, the episode is kneecapped right out of the gate because of one element. Okay, technically two. Angie and Artie, the kids being brought along on this adventure. Now, there is a very real possibility that these might have been a last-minute inclusion in the story, or maybe Neil Gaiman was saddled with them due to the ending of the prior story, The Crimson Horror, but no matter how they wound up here, they are almost unbearable to watch. Now, no shade on the child actors, they are playing these roles well. It's the roles themselves that are grating, with the constant complaining, the constant snide comments, a golden ticket to time and space, and they're treating this like they've been forced to go to the library when they'd rather be playing Donkey Kong 64? I don't know, that's what kids are playing nowadays. There's one scene where they're having fun in the low gravity, but the rest of it, almost nothing but complaining. Yeah, they're kids, but come on, give them some credit. If you're on an alien planet, I don't think I'd be complaining about the lack of phone service. I see no reason why the kids needed to be here story-wise. The blackmail of Clara's family never gets brought up again after this story. In fact, Clara's family have been such an afterthought in her three-series stint on the show that this threat holds no weight to the audience. But the kids are written out of most of this episode when they get brainwashed by the Cybermen. And it's a really bad sign when when being brainwashed into a coma is an instant personality upgrade. There is a line thrown in there about how the Cybermen have reactivated because they detected the presence of the children, and they want to use their minds, which are full of limitless potential, to house a new cyber planner, but because the Doctor is there, they decide to use him instead of the kids. So really, there is no reason for the kids to be here because they've got the Doctor. However, apart from that, this opening setup is pretty well done. Immediately fun to watch is Jason Watkins as Webley. This charismatic, yet still jaded and tired showman in a top hat trying to entertain visitors on this abandoned planet, this guy has the makings of an immediate audience favourite, and Jason Watkins is such a brilliant actor, he's such a talent, I can't wait to see what he does in this episode. Oh, he gets brainwashed as well. What a waste of Watkins. Like, I'm glad that he's here on principle, but why hire charisma generator Jason Watkins, one of the UK's most popular and distinguished actors on TV, and you just hypnotize him 10 minutes into the story? He just spends the rest of the episode hanging around silently on set, watching Matt Smith have all the fun, but more on him later. Let's talk about the Cybermen, because rather than being a background detail like in Closing Time or The Next Doctor, or playing second fiddle to another threat like in Doomsday, here they're front and center, with the new additions to the lore being the Cybermites, which are upgraded, more compact versions of the Cybermats. It's a logical upgrade, and the idea of swarms of these things coming from the dilapidated Silver Turk in Webley's possession is great and creepy. They also get thrown at the Doctor, which incorporate the Cyber Planner onto his head, and shortly into this episode, we get the newly upgraded Cybermen, the first visual overhaul in 7 years. And honestly, I can see what they were going for, but this feels like a downgrade. Firstly, and this is an execution issue, not a design issue, but they look plastic, they don't look like metal men. It could be how they're lit, but the finish and the interlocking pieces on their limbs make them look a bit flimsy, especially when they're moving. Now, they're definitely more flexible, which is good. Like, I love this shot of one advancing on Clara and catching the mace mid-swing and throwing it away. You probably couldn't do that with the prior outfits, but the arm movements when marching, the strangely round face which make them look like they have spoons for heads, it makes them only threatening by reputation, the reputation that this story gives them, and their numbers, not because of their actual screen presence. And then we get to the Pandora's box that is the instant upgrading, and the Cybermen basically playing a video game with all of the cheats on, starting with this scene.
Attack formation!
Upgrade in progress.
Okay, that's a cool shot, and we've never seen the Cybermen do that before, but now it opens up the box of asking, why don't they do that all of the time? And why do they keep slowly marching if they can do that? Like, doing that might have been able to help them during this scene.
No!
The Cybermen have been able to upgrade themselves to convert any organic material, meaning the Doctor as a Time Lord is now fair game. They're able to flip their heads around, and there's this moment where the platoon have put an electrical cable into the moat of the castle they're hiding in, and
brilliant.
Upgrade in progress.
Now, call me unreasonable, but having your antagonists be able to overcome every weakness in a few seconds kind of lessens their impact. Like, this would have been better if that Cyberman was destroyed and then the rest of the army upgrades, but having this one walk into the water, get destroyed, upgrade after the fact, and keep going means that literally everything is on the table for them, and it throws too many wrenches into the mechanics of the universe. Like, the Cybermen were wiped out 1,000 years ago when a galaxy was destroyed to stop them. So why don't the Cybermen just upgrade so they can't be destroyed that way anymore? They're even able to upgrade themselves against a gun that is specifically designed to destroy Cybermen. And I get it, this is done with good intentions. The Cybermen haven't really been that intimidating for a few years, and making them hyper-powerful and hyper-competent sounds like the ideal approach, but with this threat, or any threat really, it needs to be played carefully. The way it's done in Nightmare in Silver is so broad that it makes the Cybermen's abilities really vague, and in turn, it makes them non-threatening as a presence because the audience don't know the limitations, they don't know the rules. It's hard to be afraid of something when the rules and the parameters aren't established. It's the same thing that happened to the Weeping Angels and how they kept getting more and more abilities added until what they could do and couldn't do became vague and often contradictory, and it lessened their impact. Not only does it harm this story, but it also harms any future stories that use the Cybermen, because now you've done the narrative equivalent of, "Haha, Cybermen, I've beaten you by infinity.
I've beaten you by infinity. Plus one."
And stakes-wise, this could have been effective if the Cybermen were fighting against the best of the best, so them being able to overcome and fight against our heroes works thematically, like you've got the best soldiers of humanity, but they're not even a match for the Cybermen. But no, in this story, they're combating a punishment platoon, whose battle skills are...
Attack formation!
Questionable. Much like the initial story setup, I do like the premise of this misfit team having to fight the Cybermen, maybe even Home Alone style, that could have been fun. Though they don't even get a victory here, they get their asses handed to them, and they get teleported away by sheer luck at the end, so that idea just gets squandered right out of the gate. But even if that wasn't the case, there's no time in this episode for these people to get moments to shine or let their personalities develop. The Captain is literally just called Captain, and her death is so poorly staged that I genuinely did not know what happened or if she even died at first. And the rest of the characters, they get picked off in generic sci-fi horror sequences, which might have been compelling if we knew the first thing about these characters. But we don't. We get this moment where one is baited by a dummy head, and another where a Cyberman detaches its hand to crawl and attack. Now, credit where it's due, we've never seen Cybermen do that before, but now we bump into the overpowered Cybermen issue, and now I have to ask, if Cybermen can just run across the room in the blink of an eye and aren't remotely affected by conventional weapons, then why do they go to all of this trouble to have these elaborate kills? This isn't efficient. Also, why does this exiled platoon have all of these weapons specifically for fighting Cybermen if the Cybermen have been extinct for 1,000 years? Folks, I'm aware that this review is kind of all over the place, but I hope you can see why. This episode has lots of tiny little problems, which on their own could not bring down a good story, but here it's death by 1,000 paper cuts. And we've only just scratched the surface here, but let's talk about something that I thought really did work, and that's the Cyber Planner, aka Mr. Clever. Now, this is Matt Smith's final season as the Doctor, apart from the specials at the end, and it's great to see him get to play a role like this against himself, where it's like a bad version of the Doctor, and he's absolutely up to the challenge. I've seen people think this is a really bad performance from him, but personally, from my opinion, I think he's great, and that's mainly because of the moments he chooses to lower his voice and go quiet. It really helps to hit home the idea that this is an event that could have really bad, far-reaching implications in the universe if the Cyber Planner wins control of his mind.
I mean, I'm gonna have to completely rework the neural interface, but this is going to be the most efficient Cyber Planner! Not a great name, that, is it? I could call myself Mr. Clever. So much raw data. Time Lords. There's information on the Time Lords in here. Oh, this is just dreamy.
Also, while we're here, I know that some people take issue with this scene because the Doctor says he can regenerate and blast the Cyber Planner out of his mind, despite it later being revealed in the Time of the Doctor that he has no regenerations left, and also the War Doctor is left out of the montage, even though he gets shown at the end of the very next story. Firstly, shush. Secondly, the Doctor does put up a mental block when the Planner inquires about Clara, so he is clearly capable of hiding these things. Anyway, in the hands of a lesser actor, these scenes could have been embarrassing, but I found them incredibly compelling. Even the way these conversations are filmed on set, with the Doctor facing different directions, hiding the components on his head from the camera when the planner isn't in control. It's smartly filmed and really well staged. I love the violent jerking back and forth between the two personalities, as well as the sound effects that accompanies it, and how the story does stick to its own internal rules. The cyber planner is pretending to be the Doctor when talking to Clara, but the audience can figure out who is who depending on which hand the Doctor is moving at that time. Though the flirting with Clara is really poorly judged, this Doctor does not have a romantic bone in his body, even when he's spending time with his actual wife, let alone when talking to Clara. Also, this ending bit...
Impossible girl. Mystery wrapped in an enigma, squeezed into a skirt that's just a little bit too tight.
What can I say but yikes?
But let's talk about Clara here and try and just ignore that last line of dialogue. I think this episode in Series 7 demonstrates the issue with Clara better than any other. She's essentially deputized by the Doctor as the leader of this military platoon, and Clara is now going all drill sergeant and barking orders and leading them into battle. Clara in Series 7 would literally be whatever the story required her to be that week, because she's the impossible girl instead of an actual character. The Clara here is fundamentally a completely different character than, say, the Clara that we saw in The Rings of Akaten, or in Cold War, or in Hyde. And this isn't a case of character growth like, say, Mickey becoming more confident and finding who he truly could become over the course of several stories. No, this is Clara literally changing personalities completely based on what the writers needed the companion role to serve in their particular episode. Having said that, though, it's kind of a backhanded compliment for Jenna Coleman, because in Series 7, she plays 10 different characters in 10 episodes, but as an actress, she's still able to roll with it and make them all convincing, including the times when she literally is playing a different character, but that's beside the point. Thankfully, though, Clara leading the platoon isn't given too much screen time, as it's the least interesting part of the episode, in my opinion. The main conflict of the story is the one between the Doctor and the cyber planner, and I love how it's played and written. This is the best stuff in the episode, like when the planner is antagonizing Clara, and the Doctor is able to write a note to Clara with his other arm. The Doctor sacrificing his queen in the chess game to get the kids back to normal, and the Doctor halting the cyber attack by bluffing that he will have mate in 3 moves. This is a genuinely clever resolution, a very Doctor one, where the planner basically hits pause on the 3 million Cybermen on the planet so he can redirect all of that power and attention to the chess game. The Doctor then uses that moment to knock out the planner, and the Cybermen now need time to reboot, so that has bought them some time. But with the captain dead, who will now activate this planet-exploding bomb they've got?
Okay, it has a fullback voice activation.
The captain, but she's dead.
I think you should ask Porridge.
Why?
Well, he is the Emperor. I bet he knows the activation codes. Oh, come on. It's obvious. He looks exactly like he does on the coin and on the waxwork, except they made him a bit taller. But look, am I the only one paying attention to anything around here?
You are full of surprises.
Porridge!
She's right.
Yeah, everything about this, from top to bottom, is BS. Firstly, Porridge looks nothing like that waxwork, and even if he did, Porridge is wearing a helmet, so that's a handicap against the audience. Also, Angie mentions the coin. She is given this coin at the beginning of the episode, but do you want to know how many times the audience get a good look at this coin? The coin that contains the vital, quote-unquote, obvious clue as to Porridge's identity? I'll tell you, zero. Zero times. We get this one shot of Angie looking confused at the coin, but the audience never see it.
Oh, come on. It's obvious.
This just reads as the audience being actively insulted. Can you imagine if, let's say in Series 3, we get to meet Professor Yana at the end of that story? He opens the fob watch, and it's revealed that Yana was actually my mate Dave from accounting, and the episode spends 30 seconds taking a self-satisfied victory lap, claiming to have left clues everywhere, and how obvious it was. Nah, this is botched from beginning to end. I don't even have a mate called Dave. And even if this was perfectly set up, it doesn't change anything. Porridge, being the Emperor, literally does not change a single thing about this episode. Not one thing. And no matter how good an actor Warwick Davis is, no matter how well he reads the monologues presented to him throughout this episode, and he reads them really, really well, he's great in this, Porridge's character is given no clarity to make it resonate. We're never told why he ran away from being Emperor, other than he felt a bit lonely. And he apparently has this big internal conflict about blowing up this planet to destroy 3 million Cybermen and save the universe, but this is an empty, abandoned planet with a dead amusement park. What's the conflict here? Like, are there people living on this planet? It's never mentioned. We never see anyone, so I'm guessing not. It's like earlier on when the Doctor is all, don't blow up this planet, and then despite nothing fundamentally changing at the end, he's asking, how do we blow up the planet? Whether it was massive changes in the editing, or on set, or just not enough drafts or edits of the script, Nightmare in Silver is just a really sloppy episode. There's no other way to describe it. Even the production feels half-baked, with a wasted location. We're in an abandoned amusement park, but the TARDIS team go to a moon landing replica, Webley's exhibition, a castle, and that's more or less it. There's also the platoon base, but that's just a generic indoor location. The soldiers get attacked in a generic underground industrial room, and as much as I love the setup as to how there's a real fortified castle on this planet, but it's comical.
Natty Longshoe's comical castle.
Real castle? Drawbridge? Moat?
Yes, but comical.
We'll go there.
The platoon arrive there, and it's just a castle. There's nothing comical or visually distinct or interesting about it. It's just a castle, and that would be fine on its own, but why did you have the comical setup? Like, were you just lying? Even Porridge's ship at the end is just another hall in Cardiff. I'm almost expecting Cassandra and the Mox of Balhoun to show up to watch the end of the world, and this is made more disappointing by the fact that director Stephen Wolfender, here with his only Doctor Who credit, I thought he did a really good job here. There's some great shots, striking imagery, and the only reason the Cybermen look anything close to decent here with their new designs is due to his visual approach, and Matt Smith is clearly having fun working on his set as well. If there's one thing that can be learned from Nightmare in Silver, it's how failed projects are rarely let down by one single issue. In this case, it's little issues and problems which clash and ricochet around everywhere, moving into other problems until they're just piling on top of one another. And then you just sat there half an hour into this episode and you think to yourself, this just isn't working. The cast are giving it their best, but the production feels uninspired. The script is surprisingly sloppy. Matt Smith as the cyber planner aside, the villains are a victim of good intentions, and while I think a potential solution would have been to make this story a two-parter, that could have exacerbated other issues in the production, and made it as flawed, but just twice the length. This episode is a well-meaning misfire that showed that even unstoppable villains can be brought to their knees by weak storytelling. And I've got a feeling that we might be going downhill from here, as tomorrow we jump ahead a series with a new Doctor as we talk about one of the most controversial stories in the show's history. Brace yourselves, folks. We're about to dive into dark water. I'll see you then.